Hi, good afternoon. Julianne Bittner with Tricom Funding, CEO. And I'm here with Tom Erb with Tallann Resources. And we thought we'd take this opportunity to kind of uncover some of what's going on in our industry right now. What are the changes that we're seeing? And maybe some things that you haven't thought about over the last couple of months of dealing with this new normal of being involved with COVID-19. So good afternoon, Tom. It's so great to see you.
Hi, Julianne. Great to see you too.
It's been a long time, hasn't it?
I know. We don't get to see each other in person, so this is next best thing, right?
Right. I miss being on the road. Don't tell everybody that, but I do miss being on the road.
I know. Somebody said to me one time, they said, I just miss hugging people.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. I miss
even shaking hands with people. So.
Right. Yeah. So let's start off with a couple questions that maybe people haven't thought about is... about the rest of the year. I mean, what are you seeing the rest of 2020 look like for our industry?
Yeah, I think it's looking really positive in most areas. You know, this is obviously, I don't need to say that this is a weird time, but it's unprecedented weird in that it's, the economy is not hitting areas consistently. I kind of call it the tornado economy. It's like hitting in certain areas and completely missing others. And we're seeing a ton of our staffing clients that are actually on pace to have their best year yet. We are seeing, most of my clients right now have more orders than they have people to fill them. So they're right back to where they were in March. There's certain skill sets, certain professions, certain markets that are still coming back slower. But I think, 2020, the fourth quarter is definitely poised to be a really strong quarter. And going into 2021, it's going to be pretty good, as long as we don't hit, some hiccups that we may going into flu season and that kind of stuff. But we should be better prepared this time than we were in March. So it shouldn't be as bad.
That's for sure. Yeah. I love your analogy with the tornado because it's so true. It's like it does. It hits pockets and then they recover and it hits a new pocket. And it's very different than I think anybody would have expected. We didn't expect this. And so it's very new for all of us. We definitely are seeing some of my clients have their best numbers coming in the last month to 6 weeks. So, we got used to the new norm. And the $600 extra from the federal unemployment ran out. So like you said, a ton of opportunities out there for filled job orders, but no temporary, no staff. So when that went away, everything started shifting. We're seeing a 3-5% increase week over week with billings, which is fantastic in our group of clients that we serve. But definitely there is a positive fourth quarter, it looks like, unless, like you said, a resurge closes down the industries again or cities, which will then cause another a problem again that we weren't expecting.
Yeah. One of the things that I've seen, I just did I've been doing a lot of webinars lately. I can't get on a plane, so I'm doing a lot of webinars. Everything's moving so fast. It's such a fluid situation that I am literally updating the webinars every morning, with new data. And I just did one earlier today. And what we're seeing out there across a lot of different data points is that the GDP in the US has flattened out for about the last 2 months. And so we were going through some growth and then it flattened out for about 2 months. And that really is because of that $600 unemployment. We've seen that job creation continues to increase and it outpaces new hires. We're seeing unemployment that's dropping down significantly, but still not significantly enough to make up for all the hires. So we're seeing that is kind of a headwind with the economy. But if you look at staffing continues to be on this V-shaped trajectory. And it's because I think it's two things. One is that coming out of a downturn, the staffing industry always is the first, right? They're always coming to us first to fill the jobs. But the other piece is that it's not that they don't want to recover. It's not that they don't have the business. It's that they, these corporations, these companies aren't prepared and don't have the infrastructure or maybe the appetite for going against these unemployment benefits. And now you've got the issue with people struggling to get back to work because they have children that are at home that they have to homeschool, they have to do the virtual. So you've got that group that's not going back. So they're turning to staffing companies and saying, help us. And so that's a real opportunity for us. And that's why we're seeing all of these data points going up pretty rapidly, even though the economy itself is pretty flat.
Yeah, that's a great selling point for a company to go out there with, is how to help these companies. Let us help you. You're uncomfortable with, you know, your employees, bringing employees back, but have to work with the homeschooling. Yeah. Use a temporary. So you're exactly right. I mean, what an opportunity to use that in a positive way.
Yeah. And I think the other opportunity too is to work with clients on flexibility. And, you know, we've been talking for years about companies, addressing the talent shortage and doing things like, position sharing, right? Having two people in a position rather than one. Mm-hmm. And if you've got a lot of people that are at home, they're taking care of their kids, they could probably do it part-time, especially if there's like a hybrid model where the kids are going to school Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Right.
The companies that figure that out and have the most flexibility around scheduling are going to be the ones that are going to win this. So as a staffing company, go out to a client and say, you want to know how to fill all your shifts? You want to know how to get all your positions filled? You want to know how to get ahead of everybody else? You got to be flexible and you got to be creative, and we can help you with that. We can help schedule it. Don't say you need 40 positions filled. Tell us you need 200 shifts filled and let us figure out how to do it. There's other ways that we can help solve that problem that to the right clients, they're going to jump on that.
Right. So that's some of the positive people can be looking for in this crisis. Anything else that you've seen recently that came out as a positive, or even looking for the future as a positive?
I think the shutdown forced staffing companies to accelerate their look at technology. And as staffing industry, we tend to be slow to adopt technology anyways, right? And so many staffing companies were kind of forced to do that, to look at, onboarding online, mm-hmm. to look at, just work from home, just how do we structure it? You know, companies that have said forever, oh, we'll never have work from home, or, oh, it doesn't work, have had to actually shift, and it's been a requirement. And now they're saying, oh, well, actually we can work from home. Right. So I think that we've got, one of the positives to come out of this is the technology adoption, and hopefully that will continue with other types of technology as well.
Right. Not only the adoption of just looking at your technology and saying we need to upscale it. You know, that's one of our selling points lately, is this is the time to make change. It's the best time to make change. You've got the opportunity. You've got some downtime. Look at your technology, your back office, your ATSs, everything. And make that change now, because it's easier to adapt that change so that you're ready for when it really surges to be a better fourth quarter. So we've been seeing a lot of that, and I think that's great. Also with technologies, I was saying to you earlier, is how many people are still accepting checks as payments to their AR? I think it's so easy now to say to your customers who are having their staff work remotely, hey, let's put you up on direct deposit, ACH payments, or how about electronic checks? We just are launching right now a resurge or revamping of Click to Pay Now, where a client's customer can go on and put in their check information and pay invoices with no cost. So you have to look at solutions like that to get you your money faster, because we all know USPS, the Postal Service is slowing down drastically. And it's only going to get worse with the election and all the absentee ballots. So, if we didn't learn anything from this, we better learn that we better put technology in place so that we can not miss a beat.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think that people are more open now to talking about that type of technology than ever before. And it's, you can have that conversation where it becomes a value add as opposed to as something that clients didn't want to do before because they were looking at it as oh, well, that's more convenient to you. You get your money quicker and all that. And all that's true. And that's why we want to do it. But now they look at it as that's actually a benefit.
Right.
And, you know, and people just want to do more and more things electronically. So let's take care of that.
Right. You get one client whose customer's payment got lost in the mail. It's very easy to sell to them. Now let's look at another way, electronic way to make those payments, because the stop payment, the reissue is a lot of dollars. So it's pretty easy to sell that today than it was many, you know, months ago or even years ago. So great point. How about the staffing industries that are in those niches? You know, I look at event staffing, hospitality staffing, really feeling it all, really feeling it drastically. Most of them are down to zero, if not down to down at least 80%.
Yeah, you know, we've got clients that are focused on hospitality, that are focused on things like, you know, retail stores, sometimes very niche retail stores. You've got travel, you've got, there are a lot of industries that have been significantly impacted and are not going to come back to the levels, you know, previous levels for possibly years, right? We are seeing some improvement in hospitality. I've talked to a couple of hospitality niche staffing firms that are starting to see upticks. Just talked to one yesterday that's on the recruiting side, the search side. They're starting to see some of that bounce back a little bit, which is positive for everybody. And, you know, we're starting to see retail. Yeah, retail seems to be shifting. The ones that are surviving are shifting over to online. So, they're moving those opportunities over there and their business over there. We're seeing travel that is starting to come back, particularly domestic. You know, international's not, but some of the things that are going to take longer are going to be like event hospitality, right? The, you know, who knows when we're going to get to go see a concert again,
right?
At least with any people in it,
right?
Right? Exactly. We have a lot of empty football stadiums playing football right now, and basketball and tennis and all this stuff, but. Those are definitely areas where they've been hit much harder by it. And what I've been telling people is that you got to take a look at the niches that you're in and see what your timeline is. And if you're looking at a niche where it's really not going to come back for probably another 4 to 6 months or more, then you really, at that point, you got to start to look at how do I diversify a little bit, and what can I do that's similar that maybe is coming back faster? Those are the things they got to look at.
Right. Yeah. I mean, there's some new opportunities out there. We had one recently, contact tracers. I mean, that's huge now.
Yeah.
So I have a client that has 200 openings for contact tracers. They moved their niche into a whole new area. Call centers, remote call centers now, where you had all of them in a call center location. There, what they've done is they've looked at getting systems for $100 a month and giving it to the temporary employee working remotely, but doing that whole call center. And again, in hours that make sense for that employee. So again, sharing probably the job, but we've got call centers. Yes, there are call centers working from home, but you didn't see it too much in the temporary side. It was more regular employees. So you definitely have to look at what are the new opportunities that were created out of this pandemic. Temperature checkers. I mean, lots of those going on in different industries where somebody's there for 2 hours just taking temperatures in the morning.
Right. We've seen a lot of opportunity there. Like I said, we've seen a lot of retail shift to online. And so that's opened up a lot of things that, you know, on IT, we're seeing a lot more shift to that, you know, to the remote work and to, you know, the video conferencing like we're doing and all that. And there's opportunities within IT and in other areas for that. So there's always opportunity in every one of these things, right? There's you know, anytime there's a significant change and there's been a lot of significant changes, that creates new opportunity. We lose jobs in certain areas and other areas pick up, and you know, staffing has been pretty good over the years of adapting and modifying and finding those opportunities.
Right. One of the problems we had as an internal sales department, and I think other staffing companies are having this, is the hypersensitivity to selling right now. You know, right. I found my staff saying to me, I don't want to call. I mean, they're like, we're down. We can't use your services. What was your response to that be?
There's certainly legitimacy to that, but it's not a matter of you stop doing it. It's like, okay, well then we just give up. Is that what it is? Mm-hmm. Right. But it's really about, well, then how do we change the messaging? And we've done a lot of that with our clients over the months, and it's changed. I mean, this whole thing, like I said, is so fluid that our messaging has changed over the last 6 months to being very much hands off, you know, hey, we're here if you need help, to being more of a resource, an ongoing resource of information, you know, distilling down all of the information that's flying out there and providing them with the stuff that really can help them. I think we're starting to get more out of that, you know, as we emerge from this economy, and so people are less sensitive mm-hmm. about it. But I think we just have to be we have to be hypercritical of our messaging, and what sounded salesy in February or didn't sound salesy in February may sound salesy in April, and how salesy does it sound now? So it's I think people are just hypersensitive to you had a lot. Yeah, I mean, people are stressed out,
right?
And particularly early in the months. Now people have figured it out a little bit more. There's still plenty of things to stress out about, right. but I think at least we've got a clearer picture kind of where this is headed, I think, mm-hmm. For most people. So the stress maybe isn't as high, and the hypersensitivity maybe isn't as high. Right. But it's something we still have to look at and be aware of. And I think that, you know, it's always good to be a resource and consultative and be able to provide answers for people. And that's regardless of the industry you're in. So if you can do that and you can be perceived that way, then that gives you an advantage.
Exactly.
And also just how you can help. For staffing companies, the downturns in the economy are great chances to build relationships with people who are laying employees off, who are concerned about their own position or concerned about their family members or friends. Or there's all sorts of opportunities for us to be a resource to them and actually be of more value to them than maybe during an up economy when things are going great and they're going, nah, I don't need you.
Right.
So it's actually... downturns are a great time for us to be building those relationships and solidifying our value.
Totally agree. I think there's a lot of resources we can bring to customers and to potential customers, right? Be sympathetic, understand their situation, be sensitive, but yes, bring in the resources that you have, and just sharing those resources, I think, shows a lot. Yeah.
Even just saying things to people like, hey, listen, you know, we work with over X number of employers in the market. And, if you are interested in hearing what others are doing, and, you know, you're probably having hiring challenges at this point, like most in your industry, we have an expertise in that industry, and we have a pretty wide view of that. And if that's something of interest to you, I'd be happy to jump on a 15-minute call with you.
Mm-hmm.
So that's different than just going and saying, hey, if there's anything we can do to help.
Right.
If that's too broad, and it's like, well, I don't know what you can do to help. So instead we go and we say, if you'd like us to share our expertise with you, especially for people that are uncertain or they're frustrated about not being able to hire people or whatever, you know, that may be a much more valuable way of approaching a more valuable conversation for them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, excellent. Anything you want to share with owners that you've learned yourself? I've learned a lot the last 4 months, 5 months, where you thought you had a handle on things, and you, boy, You know, I think if I've learned one thing, it's not knowing and being, it's okay to not know the uncertainty and to tell your staff, it's okay. I don't know what tomorrow's going to bring, but together we're going to do this and we're going to figure it out. I don't have all the answers and I never will. And that's okay. And so I felt that letting them know that and letting them know that I'm just as confused and worried, but we're going to make it. It was seemed to help ease the tension.
Yeah. Yeah. I totally agree with you. I think that as people who have been doing this for a while, you know, we've both been doing this for over 25 years. We have perspective that some of our younger employees don't have, right? You know, much of the workforce has never been through a downturn in the economy at all.
Right.
Or when they were so early in their career that they weren't impacted the same way that maybe they are now. And that's the case with many of our clients, with our internal employees, with our contract employees, with prospects. So, you know, the thing that I see is that, and this is particularly with younger people. Now I sound like an old person, but particularly with younger people, maybe that was too late, is that we're seeing a lot more fear and in some cases even hopelessness than I've ever seen before.
I agree.
And it's because we've got all of this stuff going on at the same time. You know, we've got this virus going on. We've got an election going on that is very, very contentious anyways. And so that has heightened all of the finger pointing and has heightened all of the rhetoric and the just in some cases, quite frankly, the nastiness on both sides. And so we've got that. We've got social unrest. Mm-hmm. We've got you know, wildfires going on in all of California. We've got all of these things going on. And to somebody who is struggling with that, and we've seen this a lot, that, you know, they can really get depressed. They can get down. You know, on top of that, you've got personal things going on. You're trying to live your life, you know. And it's not just limited to younger people, but we just see it a little bit more with younger people. And so we need to just tell them, listen, we've never been through something like this either, right? But we've been through other things that seemed just as bad. We've been, you know, there, as you go through life, you have these things happen. And this is a once in a lifetime thing. This is a once in a century type thing. Hopefully, but there are other things that we've all gone through that you know, we can take from. We get past it. We move on. You know, you've got all sorts of things in history that you can look at that other generations have gone through. So we'll get beyond it. And the other piece too is that you can't get bogged down in the information that is out there in the media and social media. Because so much of that is meant to be sensationalistic negatively, because bad news sells.
Right, exactly.
And you've got to look past that, and you've got to be able to kind of curate your own information. And I use, not to put a plug in for anything, but I use this this free app called Flipboard on my iPad. And you can actually go and get different sources, pull in different topics, and it creates a basically like a magazine or a newspaper for you. And I use it all the time, and I'm constantly curating what I do. Not that I'm trying to just see one side of the story or whatever, but I try and get rid of some of that sensationalistic stuff. There are certain organizations out there that are worse than others are. Mm-hmm. And so that way I can kind of drill down and see what really is going on. And then that's, you know, that's just one way that I do it to kind of level set. And I bring in information from all different sides and all different angles. You know, I don't want to be on, you know, everything's all the way on this side or this side. So it's good to do.
Yeah. Great. I'm going to check it out because I need that. I feel that way. I turn off the news because I'm so done with them looking at all the negative and not and focusing on it, because it really pulls everybody down. So
great. Well, it does, and it's unnecessarily negative. I mean, I was just looking at articles today, and they were talking about, you know, these, you know, the Sturgis rally created these, you know, 260 plus thousand coronavirus cases, and the schools, the grade schools and the high schools, they're having all sorts of spikes in those, and the colleges are having all these spikes. And then you go and you look at the COVID cases, and they're down 60% in the last 4 weeks, and positivity rates are down over 40% in the last 4 weeks. And yet, if you just look at the headlines, that's not what you would read at all.
Right. No.
And that's not what you would. So you do have to dig a little more, because we just have to understand people have agendas. Newspapers are trying to sell newspapers, TV trying to sell views. You know, it's the way it is.
Wow. Well, great. Great discussion. Thank you. I think this was some very interesting topics and items and information to share with people.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I'm glad we had the opportunity to do this. Mm. This is our first time doing this. So
survived.
That's right. Yeah.
No children running in.
I see the little record button. So I hope you, I think you press record, right? So it's
right. Good. Excellent. Well, thank you for your time. I appreciate it. It's always great to catch up with you, Tom. I think you have a great insight, and you're a great resource for many staffing companies. I mean, they should turn to you. You've helped us in sales so much. So I appreciate our friendship and your knowledge.
Yeah, well, good. Well, Julianne, it's always great seeing you. And yeah, I enjoy working with Tricom, and you guys are great to work with, and talk about a resource. You guys are a resource to a lot of companies out there too. So
great, thanks.
Thanks for the opportunity.
I'll be hugging you soon, real soon.
I know. We'll get back to hugging.
We'll have a beer together and hug, okay?
That's right. That's right. Can't wait.
All right. Yeah.
All right.
Talk to you soon.
All right.